have sung Amazing Grace since I was just a child, and I've joined in on it as well at least 1,000 times. And singing Jesus loves me is a precious memory. I remember when, just as my aunt first brought me to my knees. Oh, but here I am surrounded by some things I can't explain. But the truth is still the truth in the moments my heart breaks. And if I could sing it then, I can sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond a shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in the darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, I can still sing it now. Oh, it's not always easy to join those melodies, but how sweetly they remind me of what I still believe. A voice that's raised in times like these may be the truest praise, 'cause I've never been forsaken, and that will never change. If I could sing it then, I can sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond a shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in the darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, I can still sing it now. If I could sing it then, I can sing it now. 'Cause who he was is who he is beyond a shadow of a doubt. I might be standing in the darkness with trouble all around, but if I could sing it then, oh, if I could sing it, I can still sing it now. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch just like me.
Yeah, thank you, Lindsay. Well, if you have your Bibles, I want to ask you to turn back to Joshua. Joshua chapter 20. I tell you this all the time, but it's amazing to me how the Lord always provides the message for the hour. And I don't always have to go looking other places. It's just the next text. And we find that today in our text of Joshua chapter 20. It is Thanksgiving, and I have a Thanksgiving message, and we'll get into that after we read. So if you found your place in God's Word, I invite you to stand. We're in Joshua chapter 20, verse 1. We're going to read the first 8 or 9 verses of chapter 20. The Lord also spoke to Joshua, saying, "Speak to the children of Israel, saying, appoint for yourselves cities of refuge, of which I spoke to you through Moses, that the slayer who kills a person accidentally or unintentionally may flee there, and they shall be your refuge from the avenger of blood. And when he flees to one of those cities and stands at the entrance of the gate of the city and declares his case in the hearing of the elders of that city, They shall take him into the city as one of them and give him a place that he may dwell among them. And then if the avenger of blood pursues him, they shall not deliver the slayer into his hand, because he struck his neighbor unintentionally, but did not hate him beforehand. And he shall dwell in that city until he stands before the congregation for judgment, and until the death of the one who is high priest in those days. And then the slayer may return and come to his own city, his own house, to the city from which he fled. Let's pray. Our Father, we're so grateful that we have a God who knows us, and yet you still love us. Father, with all of our faults, with all of our sins, you are willing to pay the ultimate price for our salvation, make the sacrifice we could not make. And Father, as we think about this past year and all that you've blessed us with, our hearts are full of gratitude. We are thankful. But Father, there's one thing that we should be most thankful for, and that's our salvation. And so, God, I pray that as we study your word, that you would afresh and anew remind us of the day that we surrendered our heart and life, the day that we found forgiveness, and the day that we hid in the arms of Jesus, that we might not have to pay the ultimate price. Lord, there may be someone here today that's never been born again. They've never come under the cover of the blood of Christ. I pray that today would be their day, that they would give their heart and life to Jesus today. And this we ask and pray in your name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Shortly after Rhonda and I got married, I don't know, we'd been married a year or two probably. I really don't remember. It may have been the first Christmas after we got married. But my dad got us a microwave oven for Christmas. Now, these were brand new contraptions, and we had seen them. And you know, it's like, I don't really know if we would ever use that thing or not. And so we hadn't bought one. And then Daddy got us one for Christmas, and you know, we were grateful for it, and we put it on the countertop, and we said, now what are we going to do with this thing, you know? How do you use a microwave? Well, I use the microwave 15 times a day now. I mean, every single day. I warm my coffee up. We make oatmeal in it. I mean, we use it constantly. But you know, at that point in time, I didn't really know what I was getting. Didn't have an appreciation for it. But boy, over the years, I've learned to love the microwave. Well, our passage this morning is about a place that God prepared for those who had unintentionally committed a sin, a murder. And he called them a city of refuge. And it was a place that a person could go if they had unintentionally committed a sin, this murder. And they could go and they could find mercy and they could find grace for what they had done. And I would imagine as they first went to this city, you know, they really didn't appreciate what was happening to them, because there was an avenger of blood coming to kill them for the murder of this family member. And so all they were doing was trying to hide. But I would guess over the years of living there protected, they came to realize exactly what a blessing this refuge was. Well, I want to share with you today that years and years ago, I gave my heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ. I was lost and I needed to be saved. Didn't understand everything what it meant, but I just knew there was something not right. And so I asked the Lord to forgive me, to wash away my sins. And now it's been many years. It's been 40 years or more. And now I understand and I appreciate so much more my salvation than I did when I was 20 years of age. Because I didn't understand exactly what I was getting. Man, I was getting mercy and grace, and I was getting a blessing that would last the rest of my lifetime. Well, I want you to think about your day of salvation. I want you to think about the day that God changed you forever. Because this is Thanksgiving, and there's nothing greater than the day that you were saved. The most important day of your life was the day you gave your life to Christ. Now, if that's never happened in your life, if you've never given your heart life to Christ, then you need to consider this. You need to listen as we go through this city of refuge. And you need to give your life to Jesus as well. And I'm going to show you why. But let's look at these things. Let's look at these cities. I want you to know that I find the Lord Jesus in this, and I find a place of thanksgiving as well. So think with me about this place. Well, the Bible tells us that there was this provided city, this place that God had planned for those who had committed a sin. You see, go all the way back into Exodus and Deuteronomy, and you find that God had told Moses, and Moses, listen, we're going to establish six cities of refuge. There's going to be six places, and they're going to be strategically placed around the promised land so that the person who accidentally commits a murder will have a place to go and run and hide. You see, because the law of the Old Testament was an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. If you kill my blood, then the avenger, the kinsman redeemer, we know that from Ruth. Well, the kinsman redeemer would also pay the price back. They would kill you. And so God understood that, you know, there's a difference between murder and unintentional murder. Actually, if you think about it, in the Old Testament, there is no sacrifice for murder. I don't know if you've ever thought about that. But the kinsman redeemer would come and they would take revenge. And the one who committed intentional murder would be murdered themselves. They would be killed themselves. That would be their sacrifice. But for the person that didn't, the person that accidentally did this, there was cities established. And we find that in our passage, verse 2. He says, appoint for yourselves cities of refuge of which I spoke through Moses. So this has been something that's been going on. God's had this plan for years and years. This was the only place where there was any hope for the person who's committed this sin. This was the only place they would find help. If they didn't run here, then they would be killed. They would pay the price for their sin. That was the Old Testament law. But in God's economy, in God's mercy and grace, He said, I understand that man didn't know what he was doing. It was an accident or whatever. I'm going to provide a place, a refuge, where you can go and hide. Well, I don't know about you, but that reminds me of Jesus. That reminds me that there was a time in my life when I didn't really understand it. I was a sinner, and I didn't even know it. It wasn't that I intentionally broke God's law. I was born with a sinful nature, and I had lied. And I had cheated, and I had stolen, and I had bad thoughts. I mean, those things were all true of me. It wasn't really anything that I had intentionally broke God's law, but I had broken it. And I was guilty. And had I not ran to the refuge that God had provided for me, then death would have came upon me. I would have died. I would have spiritually died and gone to a place called hell. So this Thanksgiving, I tell you what, I don't know about you, but there's one thing that I am grateful for and I'm thankful for, and that is Jesus, and that is the salvation that God planned years and years and years ago. Now here's something else about this that I want you to think with me. Look in verse 3. He says, I want to appoint you cities, in verse 2, that the slayer, verse 3, that the slayer who kills a person accidentally or unintentionally may flee there, and they shall be your refuge from the avenger of blood. You see, this person who's committed this sin, this person who has unintentionally committed murder, they're guilty. And they are in a very dangerous position at this point in time in their life. Because according to the Old Testament law, The kinsman redeemer has every right to come and take his life. If he can find him, if he can come and catch up with him, then he has every right to eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. He can murder him. He can turn right around and kill him. And so he's in a very dangerous position. He has nowhere to go, nowhere to hide, nowhere to run had God not provided this refuge. Listen, this is the man who didn't even, you know, sometimes it may have been an accidental thing. He may have been chopping a tree down, just chopping away, and the axe head fell off of his axe handle and hit the neighbor over there and killed him. There was no intent. There was no maliciousness about it. But he still killed that man, and the kinsman redeemer has every right, according to Old Testament law, to take this man's life. An eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. And so he finds himself in a very dangerous, a very dangerous position. Judgment is coming. The kinsman redeemer has judged you already. You are guilty of this, and you're going to pay the price. Listen, there is something that's about to happen in your life, and it's dangerous. You're doomed. Well, that reminds me that, listen, in my life, and your life as well, by the way, that there was a time that I committed this sin, these sins, and I was in a very precarious position. I was in a dangerous position. Had I died without Christ in my life, my soul would have gone to hell. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says that we are spiritually dead, separated from God. Listen, I have committed murder to myself because of the sin that I have in my life. Men, women, boys and girls without Jesus as Lord and Savior are in a very dangerous position. If you die without Christ in your life, you will not go to God's heaven. You will not be eternally saved. Listen, you may think you can sneak in. You may think, well, God is a God of love and He'll let me in. No, no, no. No, He won't. Christ paid the penalty. He has paid the price. There's only one place of refuge. This man, this manslayer who has accidentally killed someone, there's not but one place he can go, and that's to the city of refuge. That's the only place. There's no other place. It's a dangerous position to be in. And friend, you may be here today. You may be watching on our video. You may be in this dangerous position. You are a sinner, and there is no hope for you apart from Jesus Christ. Judgment is coming. The Bible says, and it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this, the judgment. Every single one of us will stand before Almighty God and give an account of what did I do with His Son, Jesus Christ. Did I accept Him as Lord of my life, or did I reject Him? Did I say, Lord, I understand You was a good man. I understand You did a good job. You did a good deed, but I never am going to make You Lord of my life. The Bible says many will stand before Him one day and say, Lord, Lord, did I not do great things in Your name? And Jesus will say to me, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew You. Never had a relationship with You. Man, I am so thankful. I am so grateful that there was a place that I could run to. That if I die today, I will not pay the price for my sins because Jesus has already paid it for me. I am so grateful for my salvation. I am so thankful that Jesus was willing to do what I could never, ever do for myself. This manslayer, he has a dangerous position that he's found himself in. The kinsman redeemer is coming to get him. He has every right to do so. And when he comes, he's going to kill him. And according to Old Testament law, he has the right to do that. But listen, God in his wonderful mercy and grace understood all this would happen. And so he had the plan, and he made this city of refuge. And he made a place. This is the only place. But if you're in danger because of your sin of dying and dying without Christ, then God has made a way for you. But here's what this person who is the murderer, the one who's accidentally killed someone, they have to make a decision. You see, the city of refuge is there. It's there. There's six of them. Three of them are on the east side of the Jordan River where the 2.5 tribes stayed, and three of them are on the west side. Joshua made the three on the west. Moses created the three on the east side. There are six places that God has made for this man that he can run to. But you know what? He has got to make a decision at this point in his life. Look at verse 4. And when he flees to one of the cities and stands at the entrance of the gate of the city, he declares his case. You see, he's got to make a decision. Is he going to flee to the city or not? It may be that he's thinking, well, you know what? My folks that I live around, they love me, and they're going to protect me, and they're going to hide me. And when that kinsman redeemer comes through, they're just going to put me in the corn stalks, and he'll never find me. He'll never see me. He could have been thinking something like that. Perhaps he was thinking, well, you know what? If that guy comes after me, oh, I'll just pull my sword out, and I'll fight him back. I'll kill him. Well, guess what? You do that, the next kinsman redeemer will come after you. And then the next one, and the next one. There'll never, ever come a time when they're not after you. So he's got to make a decision. Do I dare take this opportunity to save myself from pending doom? Or do I just take a chance and hope for the best? So he's got to make this decision. Do I go? Do I flee? Do I run? Do I take advantage of the opportunity that God has made for me? Or do I just sit back and pay the consequences and hope that there's going to be mercy and grace when that happens? Well, there won't be. There's not going to be. Mercy and grace were not part of the kinsman redeemer's job. His job was eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. That was his responsibility. That was what he was supposed to do, and that's what he would do. And so he's got to make a decision. Do I dare take advantage of this city of refuge? Well, there was a time in my life years ago that I didn't know there was a city of refuge for me. I didn't grow up in church, and I didn't really understand that I was in a dangerous position to start with. Didn't understand I was lost. And I certainly had not run to that refuge yet because I didn't realize I needed it. But finally in my heart and life, my pride was overcome by God's grace, and I understood that I was lost and I was doomed. And when I discovered that, I ran to the refuge. I made a decision. I made a choice that I would go and I would take advantage of God's gracious gift of mercy and grace. And I came and I came to the Lord Jesus. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful that God made a way,
made a place,
that God made me aware of my sin. I didn't even know I was a sinner. I didn't understand what it meant to be a sinner. I was a good person. Good people go to heaven, right? Wrong. Saved people go to heaven, not good people. There's a lot of good people are going to hell because they've never come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'm so thankful that God pursued me and He didn't give up on me. And even after I had rejected Him two or three times because I thought I was okay, He continued to knock on my heart's door. And He called me, and He called me, and He called me, and He didn't give up. I'm so thankful for a Savior who would not only go to Calvary's cross and die for the sins of the world. He could have sat back and said, all right, I've done my work. You want to be saved? Come on. It's up to you. But He didn't just do that. He died on the cross for my sins. He paid the ultimate price. And then the Holy Spirit of God now indwells our world. He speaks to people's hearts and He knocks on your heart's door and He convicts you of sin and He draws you so that you too can be saved. Has that ever happened in your life? Has the Spirit of God ever knocked on your heart's door and you felt terrible about your sin and you understood your sin put Jesus on the cross? Has it ever come to that place in your life? And because you realized your sin did that, you wanted God to forgive you. You were sorry that it had done, that your sin had done that. We see this manslayer, he's got to make the decision. I'm going to run to the refuge. But there's a little more to it than that. Look again with me at verse 4. And when he flees to one of the cities, he's going to stand at the entrance of the gate and he's going to declare his case in the hearing of the elders of that city. You see, he's got to go to them and knock on the gate's door. This is a walled city. There's no sneaking in it. You don't climb over the wall and get in it. You don't, when they open the door, you sneak in. There's no getting in unless they allow you in.
And so he runs to the city, but even though he's run to the city, there's still more to do. You see, the Bible says there that he has to declare his case. He has to tell them what happened. He has to go and he's got to tell them, listen, man, I was just chopping down a tree. That's all I was doing. And my axe head fell off, and when it flew off, it hit him and killed him. There was no intent at all. But I did do it. I'm guilty of killing him, but it was not intentional. He's got to confess. He's got to tell exactly what it is that's happened. Then they will let him in. And then they will open the door. And then he will go in and he will be protected. Only after he's confessed what he did. And it says that they will judge. They will bring him to the city gates, and the elders will consider the case whether to let him stay or not. If they find he's guilty, they're going to send him back out and let the kinsman redeemer have him. But if all he was doing was just unintentional, you know, chopping down a tree and an accident happened, then he gets to stay. But understand what he has to do. He has to go and make a public profession. He has to confess, I'm guilty. It was an accident. I didn't mean it. Oh, my goodness, I didn't mean it. But it happened. I killed a guy. And I didn't mean to. You see, when I come to the Lord Jesus, he's already paid the price for me. He's already done everything. But I must come to him and confess. Lord, forgive me. I'm a sinner. God, I didn't do it intentionally. I didn't break your law intentionally. But the truth is, I broke it. It may be simple. I used to love this illustration. I've used it 100 times, I know. But somebody calls your house and they ask, is Billy Bob home? And Billy Bob's over there saying, no. And you say, no, I'm sorry, he's not home. Could I take a message? You just lied. That was a sin. He said, oh, no, that wasn't a sin. It was a lie. It was a sin. He said, well, it wasn't meant maliciously. Exactly. It wasn't. Chopping down that tree and that axe falling off wasn't meant maliciously either, but it happened, and you were guilty. We're all guilty of sin. And so in order for me to be saved, in order for me to be allowed into the refuge, the Lord Jesus, into his arms, I must come to him, and I must admit, Lord, I'm a sinner. God, I'm guilty. I am so guilty. Church, I'm so grateful that when I come and I admit, Lord, I'm guilty. God, I have to confess to you. I didn't do it intentionally. I didn't know I was breaking your law for a long, long time. But now I understand it. And God, I'm so sorry. I'm so grateful that we have a God that says, okay, your sins have been paid for. You may enter into the city of refuge. You may enter into the house of God, become part of the sheepfold. You too can be a child of God. But I must make the decision to go. And then when I go, I must choose to confess. Now here's something wonderful about this. Once you've done this, once this manslayer has done this, listen, there is promised protection for him. The kinsman redeemer cannot go into the city and get him. He's protected. He is there and he's safe. Look at verse 5. If I can find verse 5, where is it at? There it is. Verse 5 says, then if the avenger of blood pursues him, they shall not deliver the slayer into his hand because he struck his neighbor unintentionally, but did not hate him beforehand. And he shall dwell in that city until he stands before the congregation for judgment and until the death of the one who was the high priest in those days. So here's what happens. He is allowed into the city. He's actually has a trial there. And if he's judged that it was unintentional, then he has a new home. He has a new place. And when the avenger of blood comes and starts knocking on the door, say, I want in, I want him, I want that man, they say, I'm sorry, you can't have him. Listen, Satan will come and he will come after you and he will chase you and he wants you. He wants to drag you back to hell with him. And Jesus says, no, can't have him. He's mine. Listen, there is security there. But I want you to think about just a little something here. Here this man is. And he was busy at his farm chopping down a tree, and this suddenly happened. Immediately, he has to run. I mean, he has to lay his axe handle down, and he has to run to the city of refuge. I mean, there's no time to go pack a bag and kiss everybody and tell them about. It's that quick. And he goes, and he's allowed in, and he'll never leave this city again. It says until the high priest dies. That's his new home. So think with me. All of a sudden, he has a new place to live. He has new friends. He'll have a new occupation. He has a brand new life. Maybe I can say it that way in surmising it. He has a brand new life that he didn't even expect that. 30 minutes ago, an hour ago, however long it took him to get to that city of refuge. But now he has a brand new life. He has new responsibilities. He has a new occupation. He has new things to do in this city that he now lives. Well, listen, when I gave my heart and life to Christ, the Bible says that I am now in the very palm of God's hand, and no man can snatch me out of it. I belong to Him and He belongs to me. And you may not believe in eternal security, but I do. If you've truly been born again, you've given your life to Christ, you have been made a new creature in Christ, then there's no going back. You have been changed. But guess what? You now have a brand new family. You now have a new responsibility. You now have a new occupation, and that is, I'm living for the Lord Jesus Christ. I live for the King, and I live for His kingdom. That's my occupation now. I may still go to the same place of work, but I now go there, and I'm doing it for Him. I'm living for Him. I'm serving Him there. I'm living and doing all I do now for my new King, the Lord Jesus. I have a new family. Yeah, I still love my family, but now I have a church family. I have brothers and sisters in Christ, and we watch out for each other, and we take care of each other, and we love each other. I have new responsibilities along with my new home. And I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful that God does that for us. Eternal security. I'll never worry about dying. Now, nobody's in a hurry to die, right? But man, I don't worry about dying. I'm just going to close my eyes on this side and wake up in the presence of the Lord Jesus. I'm so grateful that peace and that hope and that eternal promise that we have. And we're at Thanksgiving. And man, what better thing to be thankful for than this promised protection that God has given for us? You know, I started out kind of silly, I guess, about a microwave. But you know what? I can honestly tell you that now that I've had a microwave for about 40 years, I appreciate that thing. Man, I use it every day. We cook in it more than we do the big oven. And when I first got it, I didn't appreciate it that much. I was like, what are we going to do with this thing? We'll warm some water up maybe. I mean, I didn't have a clue what I had gotten. But now, 40 years later, boy, that's the best thing we got in the house. The microwave goes out, I promise you, by tomorrow we got another one. It's happened, and we did. I appreciate it now more than I did 40 years ago. Let me tell you something. I've been walking with the Lord Jesus since I was 20 years old. That makes about 41 years. When I first got saved, I didn't know what I'd gotten. I didn't understand. All I knew was I was lost and I wanted to be saved. But after 40 years of walking with the Lord Jesus, man, don't you appreciate Him so much more? Aren't you grateful for, I mean, look back over the past 10, 20, 30, 40 years. At all the times He's intervened for you and protected you. All the times, Lord, He has healed me from sickness. All the times that He's protected me perhaps from car accidents that I don't even know about. All the times when I've lost a job and man, it wasn't long before He had provided me another one. My family that He's blessed me with. Oh, golly, just on and on and on how much God has blessed me. And so how much I love Him and thank Him for it. Listen, this kinsman redeemer, no, wrong word, this cities
they remind me of how precious, precious, precious Jesus is to me now. Let me show you why. We're in verse 7 and 8. We didn't read these. But every one of these cities, you remember in Scripture, a lot of time the names have a specific meaning. You know, they give children a certain name for a certain reason. Let me share with you what these names mean. In verse 7, the word Kadesh means sacred or holy. Listen, this reminds me that I am to be holy, but that Jesus is holy and the Holy One of God has died for me. Shechem means a place of strength. It means a place where burdens are carried. And so I can run to Shechem. I can run to this place that will carry my burdens. The Lord Jesus has borne my burdens for years and He continues to do so. Hebron means a place of union and it implies fellowship. It literally means the seat of association, and that is God allows me to associate with Him. I'm in union with Him. And so when they ran to these cities, they were running to that which was holy. They were running to that which bore their burden. They were running to that one who would fellowship with them. That's three of them. Those are the three that Joshua established. Moses established the final three. Bezer, I guess is how you say it. It literally means a mighty fortress or a place of safety. Man, Jesus is this precious place that I have ran to, is my place of protection and safety. Ramoth is a place that is exalted. It reminds me that I've run to a place, I've run to Christ, and His name is highly exalted, and yet He allowed me to know Him. And I want to exalt Him in my life. Golan literally means exile. It tells me that there was a place of exile that I could run to. There was a place that I could not protect myself, save myself, heal myself, or any of those things, but there was a place of exile that I could run to, and it's the Lord Jesus. This precious person that we have, and His name is Jesus. Listen, this city of refuge was a place that the man who didn't intentionally sin, but he did, committed murder, a grievous sin. And he was doomed. He would be killed. He would be destroyed. The kinsman redeemer would not stop until he killed him. That was his job. And so God understood that there needed a place, be a place of refuge where the one who accidentally committed the sin could run and hide and stay until the high priest died. Well, just one last little caveat. We have a new high priest, and His name is Jesus. And I hate to tell you this, and I don't hate to tell you this, I rejoice to tell you this, He'll never die. Amen. My refuge will never, I will never have to leave. I will never be asked, all right, now the high priest is no longer here with us, you need to leave. That'll never happen. My high priest is a high priest forever and forever, and I have eternal security. It's Thanksgiving. We have so much to be thankful for. God has been so good to us. But I would challenge you this Thanksgiving to be thankful for your salvation first and foremost. And if you've never been saved, listen, if you don't know Christ as Lord and Savior, you need to read this again and study it. Because you see, you are doomed to death because of your sin. You will die. But I don't just mean physically. You will die spiritually. You will die spiritually, and when you die spiritually, that means you are eternally separated from God the Father, and you go to what God has placed, called a place called hell. You may not believe in heaven or hell, or maybe you believe in heaven and you don't believe in hell, but you need to read the Scriptures, and you need to hear what they say, because it says that all those who are not for God are God's enemy. You're either His or you're not. Has there ever come a time in your place when you realized that you were a sinner, that you ran to the refuge, Jesus, and you confessed, Lord, forgive me. I didn't mean to sin against you. God, it was never intentional, but I'm guilty. And I believe that Jesus paid my price on Calvary's cross. Have you ever done that? If you've never done that, today is your day. Today is your day. Run. Don't walk. Run to the refuge and find this precious, precious person who died for you. I'm going to ask you to stand. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. I'm going to pray with us.